Hello everyone, welcome to another class of control systems. In today's class, we are going to continue from where we stopped in the previous class. That is, we are going to look at the second order systems and their equivalent time response analysis. So to begin, what is a second order system? A second order system is a system whose transfer function has in its denominator a quadratic expression, a quadratic polynomial with s square terms. That is your second order system. And how it looks like. And now what is the use of your second order system is you can use your second order systems to get oscillatory and sinusoidal response. So since we are talking about time response, you can use your second order system to get sinusoidal and oscillatory response, whereas for your first order system you cannot get a sinusoidal response. So with a first order system you can get more of an exponential or a linear response or a constant response, but not a sinusoidal response. Whereas in your second order response, you can expect, you can expect the output to be sinusoidal. The time response can be sinusoidal. So how does the block diagram, how does the control system look like? It looks in this manner. So you have a unity feedback, which is fed to your negative control. And then the transfer function is given by this formula, k by s into st plus 1 divided by 1 plus k by s into st plus 1 into 1. And simplification of that expression is going to give me my second order control system. So second order equation form of my control system. And that is going to be something like this. I can, what I'll do is I'm going to slightly rearrange the terms. I'm going to do some substitution. So I'm going to bring in the frequency. So I'm going to bring in omega, which is my natural frequency, and then I'm going to bring in something called as my damping ratio. So what is a damping? So how do you make your system damp? So when I say I'm going to take a system and I'm going to make it damp, so it's just like I'm going to make my system a little bit, I'm going to add some oscillations, I'm going to add some vibrations, I'm going to add some kind of a damping to my system. So I can have a system which is without damping, and I can have a system which has a damping, and always it is the damping is helps in the case of a negative feedback. So we'll see on the details of damping when we do the pole zero analysis, but for now I can just show these substitutions which I have done here. So I put my omega n square to be equivalent to 1 by t. Right, and then my 2 zeta omega n is equal to 1 by t, and my omega n square is equal to k by t. So which means my natural frequency is equal to root of k by t, and it is known that the frequency and the time variable are reciprocative, which means my t is equal to 1 by f, and my f is equal to 1 by t. So which is what it means here. So I have my k by t, which brings that term to be equivalent to your frequency term. So k is my gain constant and t is my time constant, both of which are fixed for a given system. They do not vary much after the system is built. Let us say 60 hertz and 50 hertz. So our in India we use 60 hertz, and in US we use 50 hertz. Right, so these are the alternating current frequencies, and that doesn't change. So the same way, your natural frequency, we call them as natural frequency because they don't alter with the system and throughout the operations of the system. Good. Now the zeta, the damping ratio, is given as 1 by 2 root kt. And how do I get that is by just doing my 2 zeta omega n is equal to 1 by t. And now I know my omega n is equal to root of k by t. And putting that there, I get my zeta is equal to 1 by 2 root kt. So this can be asked as an MCQ question. This has been asked in some of the MCQ questions I have seen in the past. So it's always good to know. But now what we have here, my C of s by R of s is equal to omega n square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. That is the polynomial that we are going to use. That is the polynomial that is going to define my second order system's time response. So we are going to work with this equations work with this set of transfer function to obtain the time response. So the denominator term, when you see s square plus 2z of omega n s plus omega n square, and that is a quadratic polynomial, or that is the equation that defines the characteristics of the behavior of your system, of your second order system. So I can say that that equation is my characteristic polynomial and the roots of that polynomial. So it will have, it's a quadratic equation here for a second order system, and it is going to have two roots, and these two roots define the system properties. Right, these two roots go on to tell us a lot of things on how your system is going to be useful and how your system is going to react, how your system is going to respond, and how your system is going to do a lot of things over a course of time. And that is why this is very, very important. And now if you see, how do we find the roots to this quadratic equation? We use the quadratic factorization formula, which is minus b plus or minus root of b square minus ac divided by 2a. For those of you who are not familiar with this quadratic factorization term, it just represents the roots of any quadratic equation represented by ax square plus bx plus c can be found using that formula. So now I'm going to correlate with my a square plus 2z of omega ns plus omega n square, then I'm going to see that my a is, in this case, is 1, my b is 2z of omega n, and my c is omega n square. So I'm going to put those, I'm going to plug in these values into this equation, and I'm going to get my two roots, because the plus or minus sign in that equation defines, you know, gives me two roots. And it is also worth noticing that even in the first order system or the second order system, you're always working with the denominator, right? You're taking the denominator, you're finding the roots, whether it is a first order system or a second order system, and then you're computing the inverse Laplace transform to get the time response. So which means the denominator is mostly used, and you can, what I can say from that is, if you have a pole zero representation, the poles always is placed at the denominator. The zeros occupy the numerator, and most of my control systems, the first order systems and the second order system, which sums up almost 90% of the control systems in use today, so they are working on the poles. So the poles define the characteristic, the poles define the time response for your control system, or I can say that the behavior of your control system is dependent on the pole. So it's a pole defined system. So what are zeros and poles? Yes, we are going to learn a lot in detail about these poles and zeros, but I can just tell for now that both the first order and the second order systems are pole defined systems, which is good to know, and because this is also tested in some of the interviews, why, you know, which is having a say in control system, whether it is the poles or the zeros. When it comes to filters, when it comes to signal filters or digital signal processing, you have both, you know, both the zeros and poles have good say in them. But in control system, you will see like it is dominated, it is pole dominated rather than zero and poles together. So that is one thing you need to know. And now after this simplification, right, I had my two roots. And now what I have, what I can tell you from that is the damping ratio. So the value of the damping ratio can decide on certain things. So when my damping ratio is zero, I have a system, and that system is called as my undamped system. Now when my damping ratio is one, the system is called as said to be a critical damping. Then a damping ratio of between zero and one is my underdamped system. So we want an underdamped system, because an underdamped system is equivalent to bounded system, or it is, we can say like it is very, very, you know, easy to keep that underdamped system in a stable region of operation, and rather than going with an overdamped system, which is highly unstable. So an underdamped system can be considered to be stable at all times, whereas an overdamped system is considered to be stable only at certain time. Now for an undamped system, that is also fine when you have no damping, and then for a critical damping system is also fine when your damping ratio is equal to 1. But these are like singular values, and that means you don't have any tuning control over your control system. So the underdamped system allows for tuning between 0 and 1, and that is most widely used second order control system. Good. So now I'm going to tell you about the root characteristics of your all these systems with different damping ratio values. So we have for undamped system, your damping ratio is zero. And now your second order closed loop transfer function becomes omega n square divided by s square plus omega n square. Now the roots of this characteristic polynomial is going to be imaginary. So you can say like s square plus omega n square, the roots are plus or minus j omega n. Right, so minus 1 root, my square root of minus 1 is imaginary variable j. So this means my undamped system is operated on the imaginary axis. So let us take an S plane which is having a real axis, so horizontal real, and my vertical to be imaginary. And in that S plane for my undamped system, I have this system operating only on the imaginary axis. Good. So no plots at this point. The S plane plotting is not yet. We are only seeing at the superficial level. I can just say the roots are imaginary, and that means they are operated on the imaginary axis of your S plane. Now, next, the root characteristics of a critical damped system. So that is going to be a real root. I can just tell for an undamped system, I have an imaginary root, and for critical damping where zeta or my damping ratio is equal to 1, I have my C of S by R of S is equal to omega n square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega ns plus omega n square, and that is going to become just s plus omega n the whole square, and the roots will be, both the roots will be identical. It will be minus omega n. So the identical roots are also my real roots because there is no imaginary value. So they are real valued roots and they are identical roots. And that means they occupy on the S-plane, they occupy the horizontal axis. That is what your critical damping does to you. The critical damping operates on the real axis, and your undamped system operates on the imaginary axis. But we don't want these two, because that is what I told, these are like singular. You just get one dimension. You get a horizontal dimension or you get a vertical dimension. We are looking, we want multiple dimensions. If you want, you know, we want to operate on the whole of the S plane, and that flexibility is offered only by your underdamped system, which is where your damping ratio is between 0 and 1. So in that case, you get this flexibility. So we'll see that next. So let me just finish writing for this. So what happens in your underdamped system is your damping ratio, it can be tuned between 0 to 1, and which means your roots are going to be complex. It's going to be in the form A plus IB, and that means your roots are going to occupy the quadrants of the S plane, and as per the positive and negative values of the real and imaginary in the complex, you can go from 1 to 4 quadrants. You can occupy all of 4 quadrants, which means that is a very good system, because you can define a region of operation, you can define a region of interest or the region of operation of your control system to be in any of the quadrants, and within that quadrant you can provide a certain perimeter or certain area, that is your ROC, region of convergence, where your system can be in stable state, or if your system can be in the best performing or the optimum region. So all this is possible for your underdamped system. Let us see how the root characteristics behave for your underdamped system. So the roots of your characteristic polynomial in this case is just s square plus 2 zeta omega ns plus omega n square. So we have to here apply the quadratic factorization formula or quadratic root finding formula, which is minus b plus or minus root of b square minus 4ac divided by 2a, and that is giving you two roots s1 and s2, which is written in this manner. So this has been done previously, right? Omega n into root of z square minus 1. And now if you see for underdamped system, when my damping ratio is between 0 and 1, my z square minus 1 is always going to be negative. So the term inside my square root is always going to come up negative, and finding negative roots is not a straightforward application. So in that case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my minus 1 outside, and I know that root of minus 1 is j, or an imaginary variable. So I'm going to turn this term that I have, or this root finding, I'm going to convert it into a complex root form by taking my minus 1 outside. So my root, after I do that, it's going to become minus theta omega n plus or minus j omega n into root of 1 minus theta square. That is a complex root, and for this complex root, I can use the quadrants of my S plane. I am not confined to only the imaginary and the real axis, as we seen in the critical damping and your undamped system. So in this case, the system can operate on the quadrants, which means we are having a much larger region of convergence to operate our system at optimum performance. Good. So that is your underdamped root characteristic. And now I am going to substitute. I'm going to make a substitution here. So after I do that substitution, the first substitution I'm doing is for root of minus 1, which becomes my j. Then the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make this root of 1 minus zeta square. I'm going to call that omega n into root of 1 minus zeta square as my omega t, because now that is no longer my natural frequency. I'm going to call that as my damping frequency, because that frequency is dependent on my damping ratio zeta. So when my zeta is fluctuating between 0 to 1, my frequency is also going to change, and that is why my wt or the omega t, so the omega d, the damping frequency is different with it varies with the value of your zeta. Good. So that is one thing I would like to tell, and that is the root characteristic of your undamped system. Now, what I would like to tell you is, we have seen all three cases, so let's even quickly explore the root characteristic of your overdamped system also. So that is, for your overdamped system, your damping ratio is greater than 1, right? So we'll cover that, but then there's not much, because we can tell the characteristic of the root from what we have seen so far. So for your underdamped system, it was between 0 to 1. For overdamped system, you are having the roots greater than 1, right? The damping ratio is greater than 1, not the roots. So when the damping ratio is greater than 1, what happens is you cannot simplify the terms inside your square root, because your terms inside your square root was zeta square minus 1, and it is no longer negative, because when it was negative, we were taking that minus 1 outside, so that becomes root of minus 1, that was equal to j. Here we are not doing that, because the terms inside your square root are positive, so which means for your overdamping, your roots are going to be just minus zeta omega n plus or minus omega n root of zeta square minus 1, and they are not imaginary, they are real. So which means you can operate your values. They are real roots, which means their imaginary part is 0, and they are also again one-dimensional. They can only operate on the real axis, because when you are taking a real versus imaginary axis, if your imaginary component is missing, you are no longer in the quadrant. You are only confined to the real axis or the horizontal axis, and that is not recommended. So as you can see, out of these four systems, the underdamped system offers the best possibilities for us to design a control system and operate it in a stable region of convergence by utilizing the quadrant of the S-plane between the real and the imaginary axis. Good. So, and on another note, I have written here, what is the unit of your damping frequency and your natural frequency? It is in radians per second. It is also, I've seen these questions in some of the MCQs, so I don't want you to confuse it with hertz, right? So it is a radians per second. Good. So that is about the root characteristics for different damping ratio values. Now, these root characteristics can also be it is very analogous to your impulse response, because in the case of impulse response, your R of S is just 1, which means whatever we have seen so far is it holds true for your impulse response. So that can be done for the impulse response, and I leave it up to you to analyze the impulse response for different damping ratio values. And what I'm going to show you here is the step response. So the step response is where you get little more steps, and it is not very straightforward. So we have to do this. For my step response, we all know that my R of S is equal to 1 by S. And I'm going to do all four cases here for the step response. I'm going to find the step response, or which is my time response for my second order system when my input is a step signal. So what will happen for my undamped case when my zeta is equal to 0? I'm getting my C of S is equal to omega n squared divided by S into S squared plus omega n squared. So the steps for finding the second order step response is split this into partial fraction, find the partial fraction coefficients, and then make them inverse compatible, and then compute the inverse Laplace transform. So what is, let's begin from the first step. So what do you do for partial fraction expansion? For a non-factorizable quadratic. So the quadratic that I have here is S squared plus omega n squared, which is non-factorizable. So in that case, what I need to do is, for this, the partial fraction expansion is given by A by S plus BS plus C. So when you have a non-factorizable quadratic, in the denominator, you write your numerator to be as BS plus C, where the B and C are the partial coefficients variable, and the S is the first order variable. So it looks something like this. You write it as A by S plus BS plus C. So this is the step that you need to remember when you have a non-factorizable quadratic in the denominator. So the next steps, they are straightforward. So we go on to find the partial fraction coefficients, and we do that by multiplying your LHS and the right hand RHS with the denominator of the LHS, and that is going to be coming to be in this manner. So multiplying my RHS and my LHS with the denominator of the LHS. So the denominator of the LHS was what? It was S into S squared plus omega n squared. So we are going to multiply it throughout, and then we're going to cancel the common terms, and then we're going to write the simplified equation, and then we're going to do the next step. Okay, so let us see how it turns out to be. So let's multiply it with S in S squared plus omega n squared. Then I'll again. So now I'll write a simplified equation. Right now I have a simplified equation, and the next step I need to do is equating the coefficients. So this is the process that we have been doing so far for the first order system also. It's very identical. So we equate the coefficients in the descending order, starting from the highest power of S. So in this case, the highest power of S would be S squared. Then the second highest power would be S to the power of 1, and then S to the power of 0. So we need to equate the terms on the right hand side and the left hand side for these powers, and then with that three equations, or with that three representation, you will be able to get the value of the partial fraction coefficients A, B, and C. So my S squared terms are on the left hand side. I don't have any S squared terms. On the right hand side, I have A and B. And for my S to the power of 1 term, again on left hand side, I don't have any. But on the right hand side, I'm going to have my C, right? I just have my C for my S term. And then for S to the power of 0 term, I have on my left hand side omega n square, and I have on my right hand side A omega n square. So which means my A is equal to 1 and my C is equal to 0 and my B is equal to minus 1. So I have solved for all three partial fractions coefficients here, and now I can go on to substitute them in the partial fraction expansion form. And then after I do that, I need to see whether they are inverse compatible. So I would say in this case, it's very straightforward. They are inverse compatible means we have to see whether there is an inverse Laplace transform for the terms that we have after the partial fraction expansion. And if there is a formula for writing the inverse Laplace transform, we directly write the inverse Laplace transform of that term or of that partial fraction expansion, and that gives you your step response. So you don't have to do the compatibility mapping, which is done in some of the steps, some of the derivations. So here I can tell you from the terms 1 by s minus s by s square plus omega n square, I can tell you that these both the terms have a inverse formula, which means they are inverse compatible. So I can directly write my step response to be 1 minus cos omega n t. That is your step response for an undamped system when your damping ratio is 0. So I can show you that the response C of t is sinusoidal, right? And there is no damping influence. So there is no damping, so which means there is no fluctuation, there is no variating fluctuations in your system response. That is what damping introduces. So the step response of an undamped system is sinusoidal. So I have to say it is an undamped second order system. So now with the first order system, we never obtain a sinusoidal response. But for your second order system, we are, you know, with an undamped system, we are directly getting a sinusoidal response. And if that is what you want, if you want to design a system with a sinusoidal response, you can go for your undamped system. All right. So that is for this lecture. I'll see you in the next class.